Hello everyone, my name is Aaron Standard, I'm the founder and CEO of Petabridge, and today I'm going to talk about Akka.net 1.5, which we've just released, and offers some pretty exciting changes for existing users of Akka.net. The primary purpose of Akka.net 1.5 was to try to solve common pain points for people who've been using the software for a number of years. Obviously, this will also benefit brand new users of the system as well, but this was really kind of meant to address, let's say, paper cuts that regular users of Akka.net might have run into. So let's take a look at the table of contents and see what we're going to cover today. We're going to briefly touch on the bulk of Akka.net 1.5, which consists of three brand new libraries: Akka Hosting, Akka Management, and Akka Health Checks. We'll cover those in the next slide. And then some major changes to the core of Akka.net, such as .NET 6 dual targeting. The logging system has gotten a major facelift. We've made significant improvements to Akka.net cluster sharding, and the Akka.net test kit is now fully asynchronous. So there's no more blocking methods necessarily that you have to work around inside your test suite. Everything can be async awaited inside the test suite for Akka.net going forward. So that extends to your applications as well. So the new libraries that we've shipped, we're going to send some separate companion videos on these to the YouTube channel a little bit later over the next couple of weeks. But for the time being, you can check out our February 2023 Akka.net community standup, where we go into some more detail on each of these. The first is Akka Hosting, which is probably the most significant part of Akka.net 1.5. Akka.net Hosting standardizes our configuration model, so it can all be expressed via C#. There's very little need for much Hokon anymore. In fact, you can even consume your entire configuration directly from Microsoft.extension if you want. On top of that, we also support Microsoft.extensions.logging, so you can go ahead and pipe logging output from Akka.net directly into the Microsoft logger that you might be using with ASP.net, for instance. We've also introduced the I-required actor construct, which makes it possible to dependency inject Akka.net actors in a strongly typed way into non-Akka.net software components, or even into other Akka.net actors if you want. And we've also really kind of deepened our overall extensibility with Microsoft.extensions.di as well. And then finally, we also have the actor registry, which is our little DI container that kind of powers the required actor behind the scenes. The actor registry has a get async method that allows you to await until an actor with a specific key has been added to the registry. This can be really useful for asynchronous scenarios where an actor may not be started right away. It might only be started once it gets some relevant piece of data from some other part of the system, or maybe once it's received a special type of request, whatever the case may be. These are all things that are supported inside Akka.net Hosting, and most of our examples and tutorials are going to be retooled to feature Akka.net Hosting as the primary way of configuring Akka.net applications going forward. Next, we have Akka.net Health Check. This is an older library that's been around for a number of years that we've revamped to now go ahead and properly support liveness and readiness probes for Akka.net Persistence and Akka.net Cluster. So we have some default health checks there that check to see if those components are functioning properly. And we use the Kubernetes sort of convention for liveness and readiness to make sure that your application is either healthy or it's able to accept traffic from a load balancer. That's what a readiness check is for. And this all integrates with Microsoft.extensions.healthcheck and the health check service. So you can actually expose the health of your Akka.net components via the health Z endpoint on your ASP.net apps if you wanted to. So that's all available. And then finally, we have Akka Management. Akka Management eliminates things like Lighthouse from being necessary. It offers automatic cluster bootstrapping plus service discovery. So we have service discovery integration with components like Kubernetes, AWS. We also have a generic Azure Table Storage service discovery plugin that our customers can use to build things like Akka.net clusters running inside Azure Container Apps or Azure App Services. So after Akka.net 1.5, Akka.net Cluster in particular should be a lot more accessible and much cheaper, sort of lightweight platform as a service environments going forward. So these are some of the things that we offer in our new libraries that we're shipping. Next is we offer .NET 6 dual targeting in Akka.net. Now Akka.net still targets .NET Standard 2.0 just like Akka.net 1.4 does today. And .NET Standard 2.0 supports all versions of .NET from .NET Framework 4.6.1 and onwards. So I think 4.6.1 originally shipped in maybe 2012, 2013, 14, somewhere in there. So that framework's pretty old. It's getting kind of long in the tooth, actually, but we still support it. So you don't need to worry about Akka.net 1.5 undermining the platform that your application currently runs on today. However, if you're concerned about performance and you're on the bleeding edge, Akka.net 1.5 also targets .NET 6 separately from .NET Standard 2.0. And this is so we can take advantage of some of the newer .NET APIs for performance reasons. And I'll show an example of that in the next slide. Any .NET 6 application that references any Akka.NET assembly will automatically use the .NET 6 version rather than the .NET Standard 2.0 version. So you'll be able to benefit from all these different new APIs. A good example of this, this is kind of a before and after slide that compares Akka.NET's in-memory messaging performance on 1.449 versus 1.50. On 1.449, we are doing about, this is the throughput number on the left. And by the way, there's multiple actors running in this benchmark here. The number's fixed. I can't remember exactly what it is. It might be 30 or 40 actors. But we're processing with a throughput of 1, about 9 million messages a second. That throughput value is something you can configure in Akka.NET. That basically is the number of messages an actor can process once it's scheduled on the dispatcher. So typically, the default is 30. We let an actor process 30 messages before it has to yield. This is so we can implement fair scheduling and prevent one really busy actor from starving out a whole bunch of less busy actors. That's why we do that. So throughput of 1 is going to represent a very high amount of context switching. This actor is going to be getting rescheduled on multiple threads over and over and over again. And that's going to show up in the performance numbers that we see. Whereas a throughput of 900 is going to be, in theory, the lowest possible context switching. That actor is going to process 900 messages in a row without yielding on the scheduler. So on the left is 1.449, on the right is 1.50. In Akka.NET 1.50 running on .NET 6, we take advantage of a new threading API that allows us to naturally reduce the degree of context switching inside our application. And as you can see here, the performance when our throughput is set to 1 is like a 3x improvement. We go from doing about 9 million messages a second to doing 27 million messages a second with a receive actor. And that's with like no change in your code at all. That's just the way the infrastructure is working differently as a result of supporting this new API. Then on top of that, at the higher end, we're going from, I think, a maximum theoretical performance of like 55 million on 1.449 to a maximum theoretical performance of 70 million with Akka.NET 1.5. And again, that's like a free lunch for you. You don't have to do anything with your application code to take advantage of that. So the next big area that received some major changes was the logging system for Akka.NET, which has essentially been unchanged since it was originally developed in 2013-14. We noticed that this was a significant hot path in a lot of users' applications. And the reason why is that these APIs were designed in the style that was pretty popular 10 years ago, which is using basically a format string, optionally can take on an exception as well. And then it uses a params object array afterwards, which is a very extensible API for being able to allow an arbitrary number of arguments to be formatted into a string. Well, the problem with that API design is that it was very allocation heavy, allocated a lot of arrays. Even when you didn't actually pass in any parameters, it would still allocate an array. Then on top of that, it performed a tremendous amount of boxing was the other issue with it. So the greater the number of parameters that you had, the more memory intensive the API became. So we decided to go ahead and break those old APIs, get rid of the params arguments, and instead we replaced them with a number of static methods that all target the new logging adapter interface that basically are source compatible with the old params argument for up to 6 distinct parameters, I think. But there's no boxing and it doesn't allocate any arrays either. We use some new memory optimized techniques that you'll find in other libraries like OpenTelemetry, for instance. So that's what we use now. And the result of that is that the logging API is 40% faster. And for let's say 2 parameters, allocates 50% less memory. That value will scale, by the way, the more parameters you're trying to format into your logging strings. So this breaking change was something that we really didn't feel like we could avoid from a binary compatibility standpoint. We wanted everyone to be able to get the benefits of the speed and allocation improvements. And so that's going to require a change that is not binary compatible, but it is source compatible, meaning all you have to do is recompile your application and reference the Akka.event namespace if you haven't already. So I've upgraded Phobos and Petabridge.command and a couple of our other libraries. So have some other members of our team. It's really easy to go ahead and fix this after you install Akka.NET 1.5. All you need to do is if you're running C# 10 or 11, you can use global usings, like how we are here at MS Build, or in a usings.cs, you can use the global using syntax like this. Or if you don't want to use either of those, if you're using a version of Visual Studio 2019 or later, or JetBrains Writer, or any version of ReSharper, you can just go ahead and add the missing namespace, and that'll fix the problem for you. So that'll go ahead and allow you to get, without changing any of your signatures, the performance benefits of these logging improvements. So that's one major change. At the Akka.NET project, we practice what we call practical semantic versioning, which is that we don't like to go ahead and do breaking API changes. In fact, we very strenuously try to avoid it. But in some cases, when we feel like the juice is worth the squeeze, we're willing to take some bets there. And that's what we did in this case. And this should be the only breaking change that you'll run into. If you run into any other ones, you should report that because that's a bug.
So the other area of Akka.NET 1.5 that's received some pretty significant changes is Akka.NET Cluster Sharding. The Akka.NET Cluster Sharding system is much more scalable than before, and its throughput has been improved as well. This is because we've split the way the sharding system manages its data into different pieces. Essentially, we have a shard allocation system that's responsible for deciding which nodes in the cluster host which shards. And now we also have a separate remember entities store, which can be decoupled and managed separately. The way state store mode kind of worked in Akka.NET 1.4 is that if you used persistence, persistence was used for everything, allocating shards, remembering entities, and so forth. If you used ddata, the same was true for that. Ddata would be used to do remember entities and shard allocations. Well, these using the same setting for both introduced some coupling and had some problems. Namely, that Akka.NET persistence was quite brittle. And in the event that your cluster shut down improperly, you could end up in a situation where your sharding data got corrupted and you had to use something like our Akka.NET Cluster Sharding Repair tool to go through and purge that data. And that was really something that operators of clusters did not like. On top of that, the distributed data implementation of cluster sharding had some problems where it was vulnerable to backup if you had more than a couple hundred shards running inside your cluster. And you could actually see me replicate that in some of my videos on my Twitch stream where I was running my large network test demo where we had like 400 nodes, 2,000 shards, and 500,000 entities running around. It was really the shard count was kind of the problem there. Well, now distributed data can handle that and more. It's very scalable now. And that's because it's not also responsible for managing remember entities data, and the way we process messages for ddata is much more efficient than it used to be. So this is going to result in a much smoother operating experience for people using cluster sharding in production. And this is especially true if you use remember entities. Now, if you don't use remember entities, then you don't really need to do much of a migration inside Akka.NET 1.5. You can just go ahead and install the binaries, and there's no need to do the whole upgrade procedure I'm about to show you. So let's go ahead and talk about that really quickly. Upgrading cluster sharding. So Akka.NET Cluster Sharding, even though the internals have been restructured and everything else, can be safely upgraded from 1.4 to 1.5. These settings, the new internals for the remember entities stuff will only take effect if you enforce a specific combination of settings under your application. I'm about to show you what they are. However, one of the things that we are going to encourage users to do over the course of 1.5 is migrate their state store mode from Akka.NET persistence to using distributed data. The reason being is that we're going to be deprecating persistence and eventually we're going to make ddata the default. If you don't migrate before we make that cutover to using ddata as the new default, you're going to get rug pulled by an upgrade one day in the future. So you should go ahead and actually plan to take care of that ahead of time. So this is something that unfortunately requires a full restart of the cluster. When you change state store modes, you have to do it. Ddata is going to be the new default eventually. It's not right now. We wanted to make things backwards compatible. That way we didn't catch users by surprise when they upgraded. But that's something that you should really start creating some plans to upgrade for in the near future. You've got probably at least a year before we make that cutover, but you should start planning it now. Now, if you're using remember entities, this is where our new settings take effect. Our original state store mode plus our remember entities store mode now as well. So if you're using the default Akka.NET Cluster Sharding configuration, persistence is the state store mode. Remember entities is ignored when persistence is the state store mode. And you can optionally configure remember entities to use ddata. So if you're still already using distributed data today for this, you can go ahead and set that up down here if you want to. That's fine. It's not going to run nearly as fast as the new event source system will, but it'll still work. The ideal combination is to use D-Data to track your coordinator state. That's what the state store mode does. And then this new event sourced model for your remember entity state. This means that we're going to be using Akkadot persistence to determine which entities need to be restarted on each shard. And it's going to meter them out very efficiently that way. So this is going to give us the best of both worlds. And it's going to result in a cluster that is much snappier, much easier to operate, and much more robust than it used to be in Akkadot Net 1.4. If you're planning on upgrading and you don't use remember entities, but you still want to take advantage of the latest settings, all you have to do is set your state store mode to D-Data. You can go ahead and not even specify remember entities if you don't want to, because it's off by default. But this should be what your default looks like for all your shard regions going forward. You should have D-Data as the state store mode. Now, if you're upgrading a shard region that does use remember entities, we have to do a little bit more work. Particularly if you're using Akkadot persistence as your state store mode before. If you're using Akkadot persistence as your state store mode, we have to go ahead and add these little event adapters right here. This is going to take the old data that used to be inside the persistent shard coordinator, and it's going to re-render it in the format that the new event source journal is going to use. It'll perform a one-time migration the very first time one of your nodes becomes the shard coordinator. So that'll be the first time during your cluster restart. We want to set our remember entity store is equal to event sourced and state store mode is D-Data. It's this combination that's going to trigger the migration. If we set state store mode to persistence, the remember entity store setting is going to get ignored. So it's not going to help you. So we're going to go ahead and enable this. Now, this migration is irreversible once it starts, but it happens very quickly and it's very, it's very lightweight overall. So I'm going to run a little example here of upgrading one of our 1.449 applications that uses cluster sharding. We're going to upgrade that to 1.5. So let me go ahead and cut here and I'll come back with my IDE and everything up and running. Okay, so I'm going to start by following the upgrade guide on the Akkadot.net website. So if you go to the Akkadot.net homepage, this will say out now, Akkadot.net 1.5. If you click on this and you click on upgrade advisories here, this will go ahead and explain for anything a user consciously has to do in order to support a new version of Akkadot.net, we include these upgrade advisories. This also can include things like regressions that might happen. But this is sort of a practice we've gotten into, and we've done upgrade advisories for Akkadot.net 1.4 as well. Now, if you scroll down, you'll see we have a whole section on the Akkadot cluster sharding state storage. We try to make it pretty clear. Basically, that if you're migrating from migrating to D-Data from Akkadot persistence with remember entities enabled, here's the steps you need to follow. And if you're just, if you're already using D-Data, you don't have to do any of this stuff, so don't bother. This is for people migrating from Akkadot persistence to D-Data, which we highly encourage. All these little, boxes here are designed to call your attention out on like important things, so pay attention to them. Is we're going to adopt this configuration inside one of my existing Akkadot.net 1.448 applications that is using Akkadot persistence to store data currently. So the app we're going to use is my sharding, my SQL sharding example here. So it's a Razor page with Akkadot persistence SQL server kind of powering all the data using cluster sharding behind the scenes. And down here I have a little four node cluster. I get my web app. And then I've got three instances of my sharding system behind the scenes here. And I just ran a query on this a second ago. We can go ahead and see that we have 50 shards, and this will all add up to about 20,000 entities that are being remembered right now inside the system. So I wanted to use at least a decent number of remembered entities just to show you that this works at scale. If I take a look at SQL Server, we're actually using a best practice for working with Akkadot persistence for state storage. And you should still do this if you use the remember entities store, which is that we use a totally separate set of tables for storing data about sharding from the rest of our application that uses Akkadot persistence. And I can show you how to configure this in your app in a moment. Now, if you haven't done this, don't worry. You can still do the migration, no problem. This is just a way to keep things clean, where if I ever needed to totally purge all of our sharding data for some reason, I could just drop this table and the sharding system would recreate it for me. So if we take a look at our normal event journal, I've got 40,000 events in here. That's not going to change. That's all of our application data. But if we take a look at the cluster sharding table, and I'll go ahead and rerun this query. This query kind of lets me tail the most recent events. I can see that I've got just over 20,000 events. So we are remembering 20,000 entities. And we've also probably got another nearly 200 events for things like allocating shards and doing rebalancing and all that sort of stuff. Okay, so what we're going to see after we do the migration is Serializer ID 13 is the built-in Akka.NET cluster sharding serializer. You're going to see something from Serializer 17 appear. That's the special migration set of messages, and there's a new serializer for that built into Akka.NET cluster sharding. This is how we'll know that the migration's been completed. So the next thing we're going to do is let me pull up my application real quick. So we're using Akka.NET Hosting 1.01. We're using Akka.NET 1.448. That all looks good. And let me go ahead and... So this is what our application looks like. So we have, you know, clustering up here. For our shard region, for this little product shard region, it's the only one in our application we're using. State store mode is set to persistence. Remember, entities is true. And this is how, by the way, I configure those separate journals, as I have the snapshot plugin ID equals this and the journal plugin ID equals that. These are basically using something other than the default journal inside our system. So that way I can go ahead and store data separately. And I have this little HOCON file down here that basically configures these journals a bit more. Mostly it specifies the different table names and all that stuff. You can, in theory, do all this with C# using Akka Hosting if you want. For me, I'm just more used to HOCONs. That's why I did it this way. And then I'm injecting the connection string for these two journals as well. And let's see, we have this little basically singleton proxy that's going to, I think, run a query on all those actors. Then we have another actor right here. This populated all of our data originally. This isn't super relevant. In fact, we're going to turn this actor off for our upgrade because we don't need it anymore. I just needed something to seed my 20,000 entities originally. Okay, that's what our application looks like. Now, to actually do the upgrade, I'm going to go ahead and open up Sublime Text here. So we're using a somewhat older technique to synchronize our dependencies across projects. We're using build variables in MS Build to do that. The right way to do this is to use centralized package management, which is a relatively new NuGet feature. And we have a video up here on how to do that if you're interested. But since we have it already defined in here, I'm going to use it. So I'm going to upgrade us to Akka.NET 1.5. And we'll use beta 6 since 1.5.0 will be live by the time this video airs. However, we're using basically a version of Akka.NET 1.5 that has all the APIs and is basically feature complete. So we'll use that because that's already available on NuGet. We'll use a version of Petabridge.command that's programmed against Akka.NET 1.5 and a version of Akka Hosting. Okay, that should be all I need to do my upgrade. I might have some breaking changes, some of the logging stuff. Let me go ahead and recompile my application and see how this goes. All right, so you can see here that my upgrade to Akka.NET 1.5 went pretty smooth. I have maybe a couple of deprecation warnings from some changes we made to the Akka Streams API, but otherwise everything compiled. That's probably because we already referenced the Akka.event namespace everywhere where it was needed on our application. So all that went pretty smoothly. One last thing that I did is I bumped the version number of our application. That way, when I deploy this into the cluster, it's very visible that we are using a different version of the software than what's in production right now. So in production right now, we've got version 0.1. And so now we're going to be running version 0.2. To upgrade our sharding system, to basically migrate our data from persistence to distributed data, and to also use the new event-sourced storage system for remember entities, here's what we need to do. I'm going to show you how to do this both with Akka Hosting and with HOCON. First is we go down to our sharding system here, and we're going to change our state store mode from persistence to dData. This is the change that if you make it, is going to require a full restart. If you were already using dData before, you don't have to do this. You can go, you know, if you're using remember entities, you can go straight to just specifying this value. And the instant you go ahead and roll out your deployment and one of the new nodes comes to the coordinator, it'll just run the migration of old data automatically. If you don't do this, you basically just go ahead and leave this blank, then the system will go ahead and keep using, you know, basically DData for doing remember entities. So like I said, if you're already using DData for Akka.NET cluster state storage, this whole process will be pretty smooth. The next thing we need to do, since we were using Akka.NET persistence before, is we have to add this line down here, the cluster sharding journal migration adapter. This is responsible for taking the old data from Akka.NET persistence and migrating it to the new event sourced format. That's what we're going to be doing here. And we need to pass in our journal ID, which is going to be the ID of this journal plugin right here. If we're using the default, you know, Akka.NET persistence journal for our data, you would include the ID for that here. So if I'm using SQL Server, that would probably be Akka.NET persistence.journal.sql server. We're going to include that. Now just to show you, and that's all we need to do in order to run the migration. From a HOCON perspective, set state store mode equals DData. So I'll go ahead and turn that on. We need to set the remember entity store is equal to event sourced. And then finally, I need to go ahead and enable this event adapter for my journal down here, which I'm doing in Hokon. So this is the name of the type you want to use. This is what's available on the Akka.net migration guide. But this is all that we should need in order to go ahead and get our application up and running. So I'm going to go ahead and build this one more time now that I've got all of my config done. Okay, that finished pretty quickly. So the first thing I need to do is take down my production cluster. So I'm going to go ahead and do that real quickly. I'm going to go ahead and just have all these nodes begin gracefully exiting. And this should wrap up pretty soon. So we're going to have a little bit of downtime when this happens. All right, looks like everybody's offline. I'm going to fire up my seed node again first, and then I'm going to go ahead and launch the first one of my upgraded processes here. Okay, so that's going to go ahead and launch. And I can go ahead and see that we're beginning to recover data from some of these entities now. So that's looking pretty good. And maybe I'll go ahead and launch another instance of this process. Get that one up and running. That error here is from the fact that pettibridge.command is bound to a static port. So there can only be one usage of that port at a time. So that's what that's about. And then let me fire up this node as well. Okay, again, same issue with pettibridge.command. So we should have a four node cluster up and running. Let's use pettibridge.command to see what our data looks like. So lo and behold, we have 49 shards all recovered by our first node that booted up. One shard has been rebalanced onto this node and all the entities are being remembered. This will add up to, you'll notice here, 20,000. If I go and run this again, you'll go ahead and see that even more shards have been rebalanced. And this rebalancing process happens gradually. That's so we don't disturb the cluster too much. Let's take a look at our data in SQL Server real quick, just to validate that the migration completed. I'm gonna query our primary event journal first, but you can see here that we still have 40,000 events, so our primary journal wasn't affected. But if we take a look at the sharding event journal and I run this query here, you'll see that we have several hundred new events, and lo and behold, it comes from serializer ID 17. These are the migration markers that are basically representing a little tombstone saying, okay, you are no longer going to be using Akka.net persistence to store data about the state of the singleton coordinator. And if I scroll down a bit further, these events and these individual shards, that can all be replayed by the remember entities system going forward. So that data is going to get preserved. But all the old data that the coordinator used to use to keep track of shard allocations, that's all been tombstoned now by the migration. So that makes the migration irreversible. We are now using distributed data going forward for managing our cluster, and Akka.net cluster sharding will operate much more quickly, much more smoothly than it used to using the old setup. So in addition to everything we've covered with cluster sharding, the logging system, and the new libraries that are introduced in Akka.net 1.5, there's a couple of other important changes that don't require you as the end user to do anything, but you'll certainly benefit from them. One is that we've added back pressure support for Akka.net persistence query. So this will allow us to go ahead and basically run a much larger number of parallel queries all against the same database without any risk of basically saturating the connection pool or super high amounts of lock or table contention. So that's built into all of the SQL plugins going forward. And we'll be also replicating that functionality to MongoDB and a couple of other instances as well. The Akka.net test kit is now fully asynchronous. So there's awaitable methods for everything in there. That way you can use the sort of more modern .NET conventions for making all of our unit tests return an async task. So that's nice to have as well. Akka.net Streams has gotten some major improvements. In particular, if you're someone who materialized a large number of streams inside your application, you will notice a tiny amount of memory being used compared to what Akka.net 1.4 does. This is because we restructured the way the materializer works a little bit internally. So we're able to reuse largely the same materializer implementation over and over again. So that's one pretty significant improvement there. We've also improved the design of lots of different individual stream stages to make them a little bit more robust, a little bit more feature complete in some ways as well. Akka.net persistence has also received a number of upgrades. It uses a lot less memory than it did before. Its throughput should generally be a bit higher, although that might be difficult to notice because the I/O latency coming out of the database is going to be the key factor. But generally speaking, Akka.net persistence's built-in constructs use many fewer objects than they used to, and they're much more memory efficient. So these are some of the other changes you have to look forward to in Akka.net 1.5. So that's it for Akka.NET 1.5. If you have any trouble upgrading or have any questions about upgrading before you get started, you can contact us in the Akka.NET Discord or on our GitHub discussions page. And then lastly, if you have a commercial support agreement with us, or if you want one, you can go ahead and contact us here at this link. I'll go ahead and include all three of these links in the description for this video. I promise we can go ahead and get you the help you need to make sure you can upgrade onto Akka.NET 1.5 smoothly. So thank you very much for your support. We really appreciate it, and we will see you next time.